Houston, this is station. I am ready for the event.
Houston ACR, this is Mission Control Houston. Please call station for a voice check.
Station, this is Houston ACR. How do you hear me?
Houston ACR, I've got you loud and clear.
Please stand by for opening remarks.
Hi, everyone. I'm New Jersey State Senator Dr. Andrew Zwicker. I'm a scientist and educator at Princeton University's Plasma Physics Laboratory, and I've done 140 parabolas in microgravity aboard NASA's airplane. I am thrilled to be here today because my passion lies in merging scientific discovery with education to inspire the next generation of innovators. Today, we are here because this event resonates deeply with what I believe in, empowering young minds to think boldly about energy, sustainability, and science. The Thomas Edison Energy Smart Charter School stands as a shining example of what's possible when we combine rigorous academics with environmental responsibility. Through their character-driven education and focus on renewable energy, TEX is not only preparing students for future challenges, but creating leaders who care for their community and the planet. Here are the questions from Thomas Edison Energy Smart Charter School.
Hi, my name is Arjav. What type of data do you collect, and does it help you to study the climate?
That's a great question. You know, first I want to welcome you to the International Space Station. It's a thrill to be able to answer your questions today. We collect all kinds of data up here. That's why the space station is here. It's to do experiments and collect data. And of course, we're trying to study the environment. We have such an amazing perspective of the Earth from the space station as we orbit it. We do it in three different ways. We use external sensors to look at the atmosphere and study its composition. We also use our windows to be able to take photographs. And over time, we can take photographs and track how Earth changes below us. And the third way we do it is we use this thing right behind me. Every now and then, we'll open up this airlock and we put in small satellites, microsatellites. And we take those satellites and we launch them. And these little cubes will deploy and help study the Earth as well. So we're looking at the Earth just as much as we're looking into space.
Hi, my name is Netta. Can you grow plants in the space station?
Short answer, yes. We grow all kinds of things. We've grown wheat. We've grown lettuce. We've grown tomatoes. We've grown algae. We grow all kinds of things because learning how to grow and sustain ourselves as we go and explore deeper and further into the universe is going to be important. So as we go to the moon and then we go on to Mars, we're going to have to figure out how to feed ourselves. We're not going to be able to take all of our supplies with us like we have on the space station right now.
Hi, my name is Om. And have you ever blown up a balloon on the space station? If so, how is it different when you do it on Earth?
We just recently blew up some balloons because we celebrate birthdays up here and we happen to have some balloons to make it a special celebration. How do they behave? Just like they do on the ground. The only difference is it doesn't matter what you put inside of the balloon. If I put in hot air or if I put in helium, that balloon doesn't want to rise. And the reason it doesn't want to rise is because everything floats up here. We're all in this microgravity environment. Even I float. And so if I blow up a balloon, if I filled it full of helium, it's just going to stay right here. The only thing that makes us move inside of the space station is not gravity pulling down on cold air or dense objects.
Station, this is Houston ACR. Please stand by for a momentary LOS.
We had a little bit of an interruption there. We're going so fast around the Earth that we have to switch.
This is Houston ACR. We're back with you.
Great. Apologize for the little intermission there. We're going around the Earth so fast that we have to switch satellites because they end up on the opposite side of the Earth. And so that was a little bit of a handover. But I was saying the only thing that makes us move up here is the ventilation, the fans blowing on the inside to stir the air. Otherwise, everything floats.
Hi, my name is Arshad. What kind of experiments do scientists conduct at the International Space Station, and how does it help us understand more about space and help and improve our lives on Earth?
We do all kinds of experiments up here. I'll be up here for almost 6 months for the duration of my mission on the space station, and we'll do about 300 experiments in that period of time. And it spans anything that scientists are trying to study. The focus of the question, though, is what happens when you take gravity away? Because it's such a strong force, it masks lots of the nuances in different reactions and different things that behave around us. And understanding those nuances helps us understand more about ourselves and animals and plants around us, as well as the universe and how we interact with it. So we look at medicines, we look at materials and making new materials, we look at how we behave so that we know how medicines might interact with us or how to counteract diseases. You name it, we're doing research on it up here.
Hi, my name is Arjun, and my question is, how are you affected by the mass coronal ejection that took place during September and caused the auroras?
That's a wonderful, very specific question. Up here, we're fortunate, just like you are, to be protected by the Earth's magnetic sphere. So the magnetic fields of the Earth actually help trap a lot of that radiation and particles that are sent by the sun toward the Earth, and they shield us from it. So for the most part, it doesn't impact us, although we do see higher levels of radiation when events like that happen.
Hi. My name is Jay. What materials are used to help protect astronauts
Houston
from harmful
Station,
radiation
space
in space?
To ground two. We are finished with space to ground four. You can deprivatize that.
You know, radiation is a really difficult problem. Once we get outside of our magnetic fields, those Van Allen radiation belts that help protect us, that protective umbrella, once we get outside of that, we're going to have to figure out how to protect ourselves from the radiation environment. And that's one of the biggest challenges we have as we go to the moon and on to Mars. Once we get to those destinations, we can build shelters. In between, we've got to make sure that we take the protection with us. And those are some of the things we're working on right now on the space station, trying to figure out how to protect us from that radiation.
Hi, my name is Vedic, and my question is, how long does it take for you to plan a mission?
Interesting question, because you have to, how do we define the mission? The mission of the space station has been going, we've been on the space station, someone's been working and living continually on the space station for 25 years. So that mission has been ongoing. So they're constantly preparing for it. If I was going to train for my mission, it takes about 2 years leading up to your launch before you're ready to launch. So that's 2 years of dedicated training. But that's on top of 2 years once I was selected to become an astronaut. So that's at least 4 years of specific training in order to do this mission. So that's like going to high school for 4 years to do a six-month mission.
Hi, I'm Teslima. Do your ears get blocked in space because there's no sound?
You know, outside the space station, there is no sound. It's a vacuum. So fortunately, inside the space station, we have an atmosphere. And the atmosphere we have in here is very similar to what you have at sea level, you know, right along the coast of New Jersey there. The pressure is the same. But just like when you go up in an airplane to a higher elevation or you drive up a mountain, the pressure goes down. And as that pressure goes down, your ears need to change. Where we sense that is when we go out on a spacewalk and we put on our spacesuit and go outside, the pressure becomes a lot less. And so then we start to feel the change in our ears. The pressure we work at in that spacesuit is about as high as the tallest mountain in the United States. It's about the same type of pressure. So we feel the same sensations.
Hello, my name is Batul, and what was your scariest moment in space?
For me, my scariest moment in space was trying to get to space. On my first mission, when I was launching to the space station out of Baikonur in Kazakhstan, our rocket had a malfunction. And on our way up, the rocket came apart, and so we had to eject our capsule safely from that rocket. Fortunately, I was able to land unharmed and try again a handful of months later.
Hi, my name is Pearl. Are you provided training on how to survive with insufficient resources? If so, how long does it take to refill the resources?
One of the fun parts of being an astronaut is you get trained on almost everything. Part of that training does include survival training. Specifically, if we were to land, if we had to leave the space station very quickly for some reason, and we landed somewhere on the Earth that we weren't planning on, so that the rescue forces weren't there waiting for us, we would have to know how to survive in that land for a period of time. And so we go through survival training. In terms of resources, the space station gets a cargo vehicle that brings up all of our supplies. About once every month or two, we get another vehicle with fresh supplies, bringing up food and clothing, and most importantly, new science experiments.
Hello, I'm Clark. Are there any plans in the future to create another space station or add any additions to the space station?
Oh, are there plans? There's lots of plans. So the International Space Station, when it retires, is going to be replaced by commercial space stations here in low Earth orbit around the Earth. And NASA is going to focus on building a similar type of station around the moon to help support all of our operations that we're planning to do when we go back to the moon so that we can figure out how to get to Mars. And so that station's called Gateway. And so all of those plans are taking shape right now. So I hope that you guys continue studying STEM fields and get involved in helping us build that future.
Hello, my name is Arnav. How do astronomical objects, such as asteroids, look when they're close to the International Space Station? And have you ever got to see them?
The space station's only 250 miles above the surface of the Earth. The moon, for reference, is 250,000 miles away from the surface of the Earth. So everything looks about the same in terms of sizes and how they appear to you on the ground, they appear to me. The moon looks very similar. Fortunately, we don't get a lot of big astronomical objects that come close to the space station because that could be quite harmful because they're going really, really fast. When you do a spacewalk, though, you can see places on the space station where little small pieces of debris have hit the space station and left a mark. If the debris is big enough, we need to move the space station out of the way. And so we have a whole team of people on the ground that help track everything that's in space, and then they notify us when we need to move the space station out of the way.
Hi, my name is Coronel. If you could bring one lesson from space exploration back to Earth to improve life, what would it be?
I think the single biggest lesson that we learn lots of things up here because we're constantly doing experiments, we're constantly collecting data, we're constantly trying to answer questions, and usually that leads to more questions. But I think the biggest lesson that you can walk away from, that you can take away from the International Space Station is the power of working together. We can do so much more if we work together and we bring different people from different places together with different perspectives. The things that we can achieve are far greater than if we try to do them by ourselves. The International Space Station program has more than 15 countries participating from around the globe. The best and the brightest of those countries come together, and that's the only way that we could do a mission like the International Space Station, where we've been doing that mission for 2.5 decades. The power of being together.
Hi, everyone. Dr. Oya Tukel, and it's a great honor to be here today. With over 30 years of experience as a researcher and educator, I'm passionate about the power of education to shape the future. As Dean of Martin Tuckman School of Management at New Jersey Institute of Technology, I'm proud of our FinTech program, which prepares students for dynamic careers in technology and leadership. A special thanks to the students from Thomas Edison Energy Smart Charter School for their thoughtful and engaging questions. Your curiosity and enthusiasm are truly inspiring, and you remind us all the limitless potential ahead of us. On behalf of Thomas Edison Energy Smart Charter School, we also extend our sincere thanks to NASA for making this event possible. Your work continues to inspire the next generation of innovators. Thank you again to everyone for making today's event a success. Keep asking questions, dream big, and who knows what amazing discoveries the future holds.
Thank you for the opportunity to answer those wonderful questions, and I wish you all the best.
Station, this is Houston ACR. Thank you. That concludes our event.